돌아온 영들 리턴하지.
Welcome back to the 2016 Kasper Cup. We are about to get into the final matchup of the night. It's going to be Caster versus Chunsu. We are going to have a bit of an interview before we do get into that match. So let's see what they have to say on the stage.
Suddenly got really quiet.
Yeah, music fades as we go into this interview.
These two have very similar styles. Glasses, suit, very similar short bangs.
So Chunsu, did you expect to make it into the finals? He said, of course. Yeah, I thought it was the best player here. What does Chunsu think of Caster? He thinks he's a good player, but he thinks he's a level under me. Caster isn't happy with that.
So Caster said, well, you miss lethal because you can't add, so I don't know about that statement. What was going on there? Please tell me, please enlighten me why you missed lethal. Chunsu avoiding the question, rushing it off.
Caster, so savage.
Caster should run back for president, man. He'd be a master debater.
Says, all my Caster's classes have been exposed.
So. Any thoughts heading into the finals? I'll be vigilant, make good decisions, and try to win the final as he shakes, feeling the nerves.
Pirates are all the rage right now, but I want to win the tournament without any pirates. That is the goal here for Caster. We'll see if he can actually pull it off as the players move to their seats on the stage. And we jump into this very exciting best of seven finals.
Yep. In just a moment, we will have, as those players sit down and talk to a lovely tablet man, the Dex Band and picked, which is going to be, in that moment, may decide the entire Grand Finals. We'll see what they bring. The self-plan on Warlock we saw earlier from Caster. We'll see if that actually comes out. Caster said he wants to win the tournament without Pirates, and hasn't shown us much of that so far today. He may be able to do just that. Chunsu looks very nervous. I hope he can keep his composure here in this banning phase. I think he's writing them down right now what he's going to bring. He's going to submit it to our Kespa referee. He's submitted, so Deckless in. Caster looks like he signed. And Chunsu finally puts the thumbs up and a smile, getting some confidence here.
Caster's like looking over at him like he wants to say something, but is not going to go ahead and do that.
It's the last moment they can hear each other before they put that headset on. No words exchanged. I don't know if it's confidence or nervousness that has Chunsu spinning in the chair.
Probably a bit of both.
Yeah.
I mean, you made it this far. You've done very well. He missed lethal that one time, but there is a reason why he is in the finals. Caster just poking a bit of fun at him.
Feels like banter put aside. Is to know there's a lot on the line. 10 grand to the winner. Headsets in hand.
Now let's see. What are the bans and picks here? So, Druid is the first pick for Tunsu. Priest, the first pick for Caster. A ban on Shaman for both and a self-ban for Warlock for both. So, pretty across the board, it is standard. And we do have Mage, Rogue, and Warrior for Tunsu. And Druid, Mage, and Warrior for Caster. So, the only difference is that Caster does not bring a Rogue. Instead, he does bring the Priest. The opposite for Tunsu.
Really interesting. Looks like we're not seeing Warlocks at all in this series. A Mage will be very important here, and we're going to see if Caster can make that Priest deck work again. And it turns out, even though Caster wanted to win the tournament without Pirates, he may be forced to use them with his Warrior deck, depending on what he's shown. We didn't see his Warrior deck in the previous series, so he might have a Control Warrior. We saw that known of the deck list yesterday with Deadwing, Romash, and others. So it could be a possibility that that's what he's trying to do here.
That would really send the message if you went all the way through one of the hardest Korean tournaments without using a pirate for the final day. You would say, hey, I'm pretty good. I'm going against the meta. I know what's going on here. So, again, as we always say, you don't have to play what you first picked. So this puts even more strategy into it, right? There's four different decks you can pick from, and your opponent has to think about that when they pick their own deck.
I think there's a high chance we could even see a Freeze Mage Mirror. Our deck seems to be having great success today, very difficult to kill. And I think Rogue is something that Chunsu will be looking to save until the later stages. He hasn't really been prioritizing it as much as we saw Dahyunny do. And with Shaman banned, we're not seeing that at all in this Grand Finals.
Yeah, it looks like it. So guys, we're going to jump into game number one right now between Tunsu and Caster going into our finals.
Druid versus Warrior. Tunsu brings out the Warrior, and Caster looking to find success again with his Jade Druid. Let's start things off. This is the Pirate Warrior that we saw earlier. It did carry Tunsu into that finals. Goes for the full mulligan here with risk of patches. There he goes. You get the patches.
The risk of passage.
He immediately bangs his fist on the table, as you know, so that is bad luck.
Gonna go with Living Roots here. Just trading out that Raven Idol for Living Roots, essentially. What do you do as Chunsu? Well, he, I guess, can play Patches if he wants to get one damage done.
Yeah, if he had any other strong 2-drop, he could play it. I think coining here is an option. But imagine if he just could play South Sea Deck and get patches for free and save the coin. Wouldn't that be sick? If he didn't have it in hand, that would be the case. Patches will come out.
Caster's giving a little chuckle too. Saying, that sucks for you. Great for me.
Early Lotus here.
Oh, the BM comes out!
Thank you, it says. My thanks to you if you want to go for the full-on Hearthstone lore in English. You can actually coin out the South Sea Deckhand with this and have charge, and then hope for a follow-up upgrade with the Cultist. I think that's a pretty solid play. Without the Deckhand, he can't get the Cultist. It'll likely be killed anyways, but you could also coin out the Dread Corsair, which is much more difficult to kill.
I think that's a pretty good idea.
Shots here of these two players. Caster leaning in here. Now his turn. Will play the Jade Idol. Dread Corsair saved off screen. And by the magic of television, the bug with the animation is removed.
The magic of television.
Four Living Roots treants coming out. Sprouts. Saplings.
Saplings. You're close.
I cheated. I looked at your screen.
Is he going to go deckhand here? Okay.
He can coin out the cultist.
I'm just surprised he didn't go for the Corsair.
The thing is, if you cultist here, you get the Corsair for free. Because your weapon gets upgraded, then you get the zero cost.
That's
it's
true.
Pretty sick.
Okay.
And this is a very strong turn.
He could just go face with this, with that taunt. You know, he can, of course, kill the Crusader, but that's okay. But with Swipe here on turn four, gonna be an even better trade. That's not what Tunsu wants to see right now.
He can still be happy with the weapon upgrade. I mean, he knows his opponent doesn't have much in hand. But dealing with those minions is gonna be a challenge.
Yeah, I mean, well, there's only three power on board here for Caster. So for Tunsu, I'm like, yeah, I mean, he cleared my board, but that's okay. I have a lot of momentum here. He gets Hunter too. And with two charges left on that four attack axe, and then he's got Arcanite Reaper with Mortal Strike coming up next. He has so much damage on the way. Yeah.
And he doesn't want to clear. He wants the damage. He wants to eat the damage for Mortal Strike. Okay, here comes Spandrel, which is going to give a bunch of armor here with this Feral. And this is very frustrating for Tunsu. But he still has a lot of damage in hand. Up to 11 with 5 more on the board. It's not enough currently, but he's got that hero power you mentioned.
This is the second turning point. The last turn was the first one, where it's like, okay, I'm going face. That's what he said the last one. He's like, I don't really have any other option. This is my only win condition. And now on this turn, it's like, well, Fandral's out. And if you don't clear Fandral, he doesn't have a good way to do it now. You're essentially saying, okay, I'm all in.
You could lose 4 damage to clear Fandral with Arcanite if he's scared of, another heal up. The thing is, if there's another Feral, then he's just going to choose armor anyways, even if Fandral isn't there. So I think this is the right choice. Oh, no!
That elephant might spell the loss here for Tunsu.
And without less than 13 health here, he can't clear it with Mortal Strike.
Well, he gets that. It's not great, but...
It's pretty terrible, in fact.
It's basically all he can do.
Yeah, there's no other choice here.
That would have been perfect if he didn't have a taunt. There was a chance that Tunsu could have killed him in 2 turns. But now, that Heroic Strike wasted. This guy's got to go face.
You always want to use your charge minions when your opponent doesn't have taunt, save your direct damage for when they do. Oh, this is a free card draw and clear. This Innervate, not too helpful though. It will likely use it, to be honest.
To get the Gadgets,
to get the Gadgets and just to threaten lethal next turn.
Yeah. It's probably what he's thinking about now.
The
I
one
think
health,
you have to do it.
Like, let's think of how he could die. He doesn't have less than 12. But he will if he goes face here. He could actually wait and not attack to drop him below 12, so he could just do 1 damage here. And even if he did, it's not 2 Mortal Strikes, so...
Oh,
he can't use both Mortal Strikes, even if he had a second one. And if he has one, or, you know, if he uses one with this, it's still only 11 damage, so he's fine either way. In fact, I think this is just simply GG.
It looks like it. That's dead on board, and no way to kill the Druid. So game one, going over to Caster, holding off the aggression of Tunsu's Warrior.
Very, very powerful win here with the Druid right away. And with the Priest deck he used earlier, it looked strong. It looked very good against many types of decks in this meta. That's definitely going to be one of his tougher ones. He has his own Warrior, Mage, and Priest to go. And when you expand a best of 5 to a best of 7, suddenly the matchups become a lot more intricate, and you no longer want to hide anything because this is the final. So we might see a switch here away from the Warrior. I think there's a high chance, in fact, we do, by Tunsu. He's got Rogue, Mage, and Druid to choose from himself. He made a switch back into the Druid.
Yeah, I think that's a decent call. I think he there's a pretty good chance that he goes back into the Druid. See what he can do with that. Caster, I'm curious about what he's going to use and what he expects out of Chung Tzu. Either way, guys, we're going to find out in just a few seconds as we go into game number two of Chung Tzu versus Caster here at the 2016 Hearthstone Kespa Cup Finals. Priest versus Rogue. Priest coming out here early for Caster. Chung Tzu will meet him with the Rogue. Wants to get patches out of the hand. Will likely keep the Swashburglar. As that will be an effective way to grab another class card. Gets the Van Cleef, but does not have any sort of coins or any activation options for that. You don't want to use that early. Shadow Word Death could be in hand. Not a very powerful card.
Shadow Word Pete picked up from the Swashburglar.
That could be quite strong against one of the opening cards, in fact, that Caster has to offer.
Picks up a dragon, so now he can use the Nether Spite Historian on the next turn. Just to make sure that he gets the value out of that. Of course, it only works if you're holding a dragon.
Well, this hand here for Chung Tzu forces him into a dagger play. He will hit with it because he has a hand that's so difficult to use that these two mana crystals to refresh will not be an issue.
Onyxia, Azur Drake, or Twilight Whelp, and he goes for Twilight Whelp.
I think you definitely could make arguments for the Drake as well. But
yeah, I kind of like the Zer Drake, but Draconoid Operative on turn 5, I suppose.
Yeah, seems to be that's what he's looking for. We'll see SI7 Agent used here just to continue to control the board. And he's going to go face again, and another Spite Historian not going to be able to clear much on her own. She has to do it pretty slowly. Saves the dagger because, with that top deck to SI7, he finally did need the mono. I was talking about. He's going to heal, allowing that Nether Spite to do a little bit more, but probably see Shadow Word Pain come out here if there's no better play.
Yeah. I like the play of the Cabal Talon Priest, too, over the Courier, just because it's a better body to have on the board. And you already have a really nice curve coming into the next turns. So you can just use the Courier next turn with the Twilight Whelp. And then go into Dragonite Operative or the Azur Drake. Another option is to coin out one of those.
Yeah, coin five out Drake drops. And the Investigator. Yeah. A nice way to clear the Talon Priest is just to use the Shadow Word Death, as I mentioned before. Don't want to use Eviscerate if you can help it, because that's damage you want towards the face. He's got Blood Moon Cells. There's no right play here for Chung Tzu. There's no optimal play. There's trade-offs for every move he could make. Thalnos would get him card draw, but he really doesn't want that. The only card he's really missing is a counterfeit coin. If he had a counterfeit coin or prep, he could set up for a concealed turn later on. This is the obvious choice, I would argue. He's even going to clear the Historian. There's no way to really put massive pressure on right now. Place Thalnos.
No easy way for a priest to clear that off at this point. He does draw the Blackwing Corruptor, and that's going to go towards the SS7 agent anyway. But now he doesn't really have a combo piece for the Eviscerate. So.
Prep in hand here, but if he had the counterfeit coin. Along with that, he could set up for a conceal turn. He may just allow the Corruptor to live. Another option is to run in the Thalnos and see what he gets. If he does happen to top deck that counterfeit coin, this becomes an incredible turn. Small chance, though, with currently 21 cards in deck.
Yeah, and they don't always run to counterfeit coins. So lots on the line and lots on the mind here of Chun Su.
Yeah. I think he's going to go for it.
He's going to do
free damage and trade. Loses the base damage, but wants to maintain control. And he will actually play a 4-4 Edwin Van Cleef to maintain some sort of presence.
See what he gets from the deck. Those three choices are not very good. Backstab, counterfeit coin, and small-time Buccaneer.
Definitely wants to avoid the Buccaneer, I'd say. Backstab or the coin, and
probably backstab. It's just free removal. Okay, he goes for the coin. That's kind of interesting.
Yeah, the coin is not bad. It can allow him just a bit more aggressive plays. Here we go. Now we're going to see this turn come to fruition. Can finally get the conceal. This is a very powerful turn for Chun Su. If there was no Dragon Blood Potion, or Dragon Fire Potion, excuse me, then this would, like, potentially be a game-winning turn on the side of Caster. Because that's in hand, this will be cleared, but he's going to draw a lot of cards.
Prep, see exactly how many.
Can even backstab
but
himself.
But if he fans, then he can't conceal.
Don't feel to let them know. He's going to fan. And to be honest, he doesn't know there's Dragon Fire, but I think he's considering the option. If he conceals, this doesn't matter anyways. He gets another Auctioneer, which is really nice.
Yeah, it really is. And here comes the Dragon Fire Potion. A great play for Chun Su to avoid the Dragon Fire Potion even without knowing that it was in the hand, and now he can throw out another one.
Exactly, and this is so, so powerful. He's going to wait because he doesn't have much more activation right now. He's still looking for those counterfeit coins. Gets Leroy. And Reno in hand. Chun Su is playing this so carefully. A lot of respect for me coming out from his plays. This is a dead card.
He has a Sarah next turn. With that counterfeit coin, that's super hard for a rogue to get rid of without sap.
I'd say freeze is strong, dread is strong. He goes for the potion of madness. I don't know what he's going to use that for.
Caster going for everything that we're not saying.
I mean, I could see the counterfeit coin, but this potion of madness.
I don't know about that.
He's going to need his shrink to actually get value from that. All right, here we go. Backstab to the mind control tech. To Cold Blood, one of two. Cold Blood the Drake. Yeah, this may just be a conceal.
Yep, attack, conceal, down to 15. And a pretty awkward spot now for the priest because he does have Reno, but, you know, 15 health. He has to consider that if he doesn't use Reno, he's going to die. So he will use Reno and get rid of this weapon. Let's put another minion on the board, too.
Now, this turn for Chun Su, he's looking for massive amounts of damage so that he can get into Leroy range.
So, 10 in hand and 12 on board. So, 22, 23 with the weapon. So, he's not close enough.
I think fan first, get two cards. You want to make sure that your Cold Bloods get full activation. Two damage, two with the spell power will actually clear the prep and the other minion. Here's the prep.
Not going to prep just yet.
Yeah, wants to Cold Blood first. We'll probably double the Cold Blood, I imagine.
Throw it onto the Auctioneer, picks up Eviscerate.
It's always valuable to use your minion attacks when there's no taunts, and right now that's the case.
He's at 26 damage right now. The Leroy's preps and Eviscerates, plus everything on board.
He could get more. He's going to clear with Eviscerate.
27 damage, actually, with the spell power.
Yeah.
Just going to use it on the Reno, clear with the dagger, and get another minion on board.
This is a really powerful setup. Right now, Caster needs an another Dragonfire potion.
In his Reno deck.
Not gonna happen. He's gonna draw for anything.
See what he draws.
Raza.
Seeds.
Not enough. And Rogue has always been extremely strong against Priest, as Priest doesn't have too much reliable removal against those concealed minions that are 4 health and also 4 damage. You know, back in the day when Shadowward Pain, Shadowward Death used to be very popular cards, it was very hard for the Priest to get rid of. So we see that the Rogue is still victorious, is still stronger than the Priest in that matchup. And he does take the win, ties it up 1-1.
1-1. And 3 decks remaining apiece. Rogue and Druid removed. We'll see a totally different matchup here. Would love to see the Freeze Mage Mirror. That would get super interesting.
Yeah.
As it would be mostly draw-based, but there's a lot of complex decisions that can go into that. You could try to race, or even play the fatigue game. Okay. Cast are definitely feeling the heat after that game, but it's tied up 1 apiece. Really tense here. $10,000 on the line.
Yeah. So much money on the line. A lot of pride winning the Kespa Cup. And a big decision coming into this one to decide which deck these two players will pick. Going into game number 3. Let's check it out right now as we go into it.
Warrior for caster, Chunsu brings Druid. And we do see this variation even includes Justicar. And we talked about how this could be a very control-based warrior, and it looks to be absolutely that with the Bran Bloodhoof, what's that card called again? Sorry,
Bloodhoof
Brave, yeah. Sorry, confusing that with the other Bloodhoof. But anyway, Bloodhoof Brave. The Ghoul Shield Slam. That's written on the wall here.
And watch him take a long time and act as if he has a decision to make. This is actually important. You know, he's got a little smirk on his face, but he's bending forward. Maybe he's trying to hide it. And then, of course, Chunsu. See what he goes for. Raven Idol.
If he thinks it's aggro, Bite and Swipe are both quite good. I think Swipe definitely way better in this case. Shows the Fireball Axe.
Yeah, this is what, you know, the old matchup of going against Control Warrior used to look like. Turn 2, play Fiery War Axe, pass.
Dare you to play anything. Mandrill available next turn. Execute, long time no see.
The only thing is just, like, from the outside looking in, like, we haven't seen this matchup too much or at all yet in this tournament. I wonder who has the advantage here versus, you know, that Jade, the Jade Druid going against the Control Warrior.
Honestly, it really just depends on how the Druid ramps, because in this case he has no Jade cards in hand.
Yeah, so it might not even be Jade.
Yeah, could be a Kuhn deck. Definitely possible. With the Auctioneer, looks like it really could be either. I'll have to wait and see. Vandrill here is still unusable. And he made... The thing about this card is so powerful for his deck, like this, you may just have to pass. Yeah, he's going to Nourish. Goes for Crystals. Little armor, but not hit. This is an Enrage card. And they will be Enraged. And the Justicar draw here is absolutely amazing, too. We'll start to gain a lot more health. Caster with a big smile.
Oh, boy.
His deck is superior. We see Malygos, which means this is going to be some variation. Could even be Moonfire. We'll have to wait and see if we see an Aviana or a Kuhn come out later.
Yeah, and the thing about this is that if you have that big Aviana and Tycoon turn where you get like five minions on board, something ridiculous, Brawl is going to be perfect, right? It's the perfect card to go against that. Generally, Warriors don't have that, but now you do when you're playing Control Warrior, so I could see how this could definitely work out here for Caster.
Looks like he's almost considering killing the ghoul instead to get value out of that. Oh, wow, he's going to do it this way. Okay, execute can be used to clear this, as well as Shield Slam. And also his weapon, I suppose. He's going to play Juice to Guard. Gain double the armor, tank up. Now gained here, 4 armor a turn.
Gorehowl, I feel like I'm living in the past.
We are right now, absolutely.
It's almost like he just brought one of the old decks, like one of the old deck lists.
He looked at his old deck book from like 2006, and he was like, this is the one.
I wonder if he has any new cards in it. We haven't seen any yet.
Yeah. Revenge is, you know, not what you see from the original decks, and of course I'm joking about 2006, but like 2014, 2015 deck we're looking at right now.
Yeah.
Revenge is fairly new. It's not really useful against this type of druid. It's very useful against aggro. Decks very powerful against Shaman, for example. He knew he wasn't going to face Shaman, though, because he banned it. And we're just starting to see these draws fly through. He's looking for Kuhn, but the outstrong's good. It's very clear. He's looking for Kuhn and Aviana. Saves his Moonfire because he wants to make sure that he can do the damage to face against such a hefty health pool. And the draw. It's a Raven Idol.
Could Raven Idol into Alexstrasza here? Get the warrior low, get him, you know, a bit scared.
Yeah, it does kind of reveal the theme of the deck, but I think that Caster's already figured it out.
And there's no more draw, really, so he wants the Thorisen, but, you know, it's not going to appear magically. Innervate is nice.
Jade Idol is the worst choice. He's probably going to take Innervate. Raven Idol could get him something else this turn, but if he gets Aviana, Innervate is so invaluable. It can mean the difference between winning and losing.
Yeah, I really like Innervate here. He's just putting a lot of thought into it, thinking about exactly what other cards are there that he could draw with the Raven Idol.
If he Raven Idol's into Nourish, that's really good. Like, that would be a great draw for him. But there's no way to know for certain. The other side of the coin, of course, is if you Innervate, there's no way to know if you're going to get... you're never ever going to draw, Aviana. Science to take the Raven Idol and Alexstrasza's. Revenge can be used as a trigger here for Execute. We'll use Bash instead.
Then armor up, and this is what we're used to seeing out of the Control Warriors, just a crazy amount of armor. So you Alexstrasza, but he gains 7 health in one turn and gets rid of your dragon. Kind of frustrating. He's going to give it another shot to the Raven Idol.
To be honest, I still feel like with no threats on the board, Chunsu is still very much ahead. He doesn't have Aviana yet, but he's in a really nice spot. Could even power, you know, drop out a druid here. And in this case, Power of the Wild, not really thinking that's the way. Savage Roar works well once he gets Aviana. Can be a finishing tool.
Living Roots is good for the Malagos. Yep. So, it, you know, that one mana, immense amount of damage. It's usually 2, but with Malagos, it's 7. So... gets his second swipe, too.
Yeah. I think he can just Druid of the Claw here.
Yeah, seems good.
Hero Power Face.
Get a minion out there. You're facing a warrior that has 4 cards in hand. You're not scared at all of anything.
He could even charge this.
Yeah, I think he would, just because, like, if you were going to go for that, it would just die to the Gorehowl. So you want to get that 8 damage in instead of just the 4. But it just goes for this to give it 2 targets, so that it's harder to clear.
Shield Slam. Another powerful answer going forward. Already tank up available. That's it. As you mentioned, taking 2 charges here. We'll draw another Living Roots. Nobody wants. And now it must be time to really consider the Druid of the Claw. How much of the Gorehowl now? 6? Five. With five on the Gore Howl, it would be great to force a Shield Slam to be used if he can. Or perhaps the other Execute if Caster runs two. In a deck like this, you probably do. Barrels for the damage instead, with no minion to clear with. It could be four free damage with an Aviana Druid of the Claw. Can I do both?
Yeah, he wants to just keep him in range of the Malagos combo, which I definitely like. I mean, this is going to get him down to 11. And if he ever draws Aviana with Kuhn, the game is just over.
This is terrible. He has no minions in hand. He's going to use Revenge.
Double revenge.
You know what? If he actually just plays Malgus, there's no way to clear it right now either. He doesn't have enough armor. And if he's hoping, you know, to draw an execute potentially, he's just going to play it now. Does he have lethal?
I think seven he might
plus
actually. 7 plus
6. 13. Six. He's very close, and it's so difficult to remove this. He takes all the armor away.
And he has double swipe, too, for next turn, so there's almost no way that the warrior gets enough armor, even with Shield Slam. That's going to be it. I mean, he's going to try to brawl and get rid of that, but it's not going to matter with the cards that Tunsu has in hand.
There's a reason this deck is out of the meta. He gets the brawl, but it won't matter. 8 damage in hand.
I'm sure he's like, oh, okay, I stayed alive. He has 3 swipes in hand, though. It's going to be way too much. And that's going to be Caster going down with his control warrior. There's the shield block that may have saved him. Just barely, but not going to be enough. As he does go down, and Tunsu takes game number 3, goes up to a 2-1 lead.
Malagos Druid, a tough deck to win with. And he takes it away. The real question is, what were the big minions in the deck of Caster? He was drawing into infinity removal for aggro, but he hit a bad matchup. It was a matchup where he's just looking to taunt his way into killing big mains and winning by tempo, but there was no Ragnaros, there was no big threat. He probably had Grommash, but we never saw it. He had the Gore Howl for removal, and it was a bad matchup for that deck. And so that was a good call by Tunsu to bring the Druid out. Wins it.
Yeah. And I hope that deck has other matchups. Maybe he was hoping to hit a different matchup like Mage. If he hits Freeze Mage with that, he's going to be in a fantastic spot. He's going to take the win. And I think that's where he needs to take the win. He might be forced into playing Warrior over and over until he hits Mage. And in that case, Tunsu might just play his own Warrior this time. And if it's a more aggressive Warrior, maybe he can take that matchup too.
I think that Caster is going to be... His Warrior will be fairly strong against both the Mage because of the armor and then the Warrior because of all the taunts. But we'll see.
Looks that way. Let's jump into game number 4 right now and see if he can tie it up.
Freeze Mage.
Wow. Very surprised that Tunsu brought out the Mage, to be honest. I thought he would bring out his own Warrior, but maybe he feels like... Oh, well, actually, as I say that, look at the cards that he has in his hand.
Yeah, it's not Freeze
it's
Mage.
It's not Freeze Mage. So, what exactly are we going to be seeing here? Some kind of Tempo Mage?
Looks like it
mid-range?
Will either be Tempo or it will be a Reno Mage with Kazakus and... the ability to just simply take tempo. Like the Reno Mage is somewhat of a tempo mage. Now it's weaker in its tempo form, but it's strong against aggro as well. And perhaps he was thinking Caster was going to change decks here. And when you play that turn one Mana Worm right now, Caster probably has a big question mark on his head. And I'm not talking about a secret.
Puts his hand up to his chin like, what?
He like goes to the left where it shows the history and it doesn't say created by anything and he's like, no, you're really, that's real. It's a polymorph in hand now too. And
come on, man, where's that dirty rat?
Dirty rat would have been so So risky here.
Would have been so terrible, but I always love to see it.
Don't worry, you'll see him eventually, no doubt. Alright, so this wastes a turn, essentially, of Chansu. Sylvanas, we didn't see that last game. That definitely could have been a game changer. Never came out, so bad luck by Caster there. Yeah, Water Elemental, pretty powerful here. Water Elemental is very powerful against Warrior because it can freeze his weapons in general. Bloodhoof Brave, not a bad drop here. And the question is, will he draw with it? He can also Ghoul for an extra draw, but that's so greedy. It doesn't really do much to control the board.
Yeah, it's kind of just giving two worthless minions for this Water Elemental to eat, and you're just getting one extra card, so this seems to be the better play. And with only one copy of each card in hand, it looks to be Reno Mage more and more.
He's got Poly. He really wants to get that early advantage. We'll clear off the draw here.
Yeah.
Leave the Polymorph's Sheep alone.
Remember, in one of our earlier games, I said denying draws from Freeze Mages is really important with the Accolade of Pain, but it's equally as important from denying draws from the Control Warrior, because Control Warrior doesn't have any other way to draw cards except with that and Shield Block. So
this is a tough turn, and if he actually gets locked into being constantly frozen and unable to weapon, to use his weapon, that's so terrible for a weapon-based class like Warrior. Not as weapon-based as Shaman or Rogue right now, I'd say, in a lot of ways, but especially, well, I'd say it is when you're playing Pirate, but in Control it's not as important, but my point is, if he gets locked down on a board where the Water Elemental can constantly freeze face, and all weapons are dead cards. He already used Polymorph. Sylvanas, pointing out Sylvanas is not a terrible choice here. The Ghoul can only kill the Spellcaster here.
He really wants to get rid of that Water Elemental.
Yeah, that's the fear. He needs, no doubt, as we have figured out already, this is a Reno deck. He does not want to be frozen every turn against it. He knows that's going to be the last Water Elemental in the deck.
Free trade for that Sorcerer's Apprentice against the Ravaging Ghoul, but that was the only real way to get rid of the Water Elemental efficiently. Well, semi-efficiently.
Reno confirms our suspicions.
Oh, he's even got a Frostbolt. He's not going to get rid of that Sorcerer's Apprentice just yet.
Here comes Sylvanas. He actually runs Ice Block as well. We don't always see that in these Reno Mage decks, but when we do, it will prevent
leaving. It's cool because the second it gets procced, you Reno the next turn. So you just get it out there right at the most efficient time.
If he doesn't want his minions to get stolen, he can just trade both of them. That's obviously never what you want. That's why Sylvanas is so powerful. He can also just freeze Sylvanas with Blizzard and go face. He's very all-in, but looks like that's what he's got planned here.
Well, he's not even gonna freeze. He's just gonna go.
Well, Sylvanas won't die.
Unless he's revenge,
though. And he will die now. Or she, I should say. Dirty Rat pulls out the Reno. This is, you and I talked about this a lot. You can pull Reno out with Dirty Rat, and it's very powerful, but in this matchup, Chansu isn't worried about lethal. He's not worried about lethal at all versus a Control Warrior. So this is strong in some senses. He's not gonna have to heal later if he runs out of steam because he doesn't have very many minions left in hand. But
he can steal Reno.
He will steal it. That's what he was looking for. Like, what am I gonna steal? Whatever I Dirty Rat, I steal.
It was either, well, he could have ran into the Reno too and killed him and then taken the drink, but he wanted Reno more. Or actually, no, because he's at 12 health, I guess he couldn't have. But either way, he does steal that Reno.
Yeah, this is a scary thing because he only has a vendor. Okay, Kazagus, he draws Kazagus. This is critical. Without this, his deck would run out of steam real quick. He may save it for next turn, and then the following turn he can use a 10 mana mega spell and just Blizzard here and ping off the Reno. He could also play, of course, Flamestrike. Play better.
Yeah, you're not scared of a frozen 2-1. Getting it next turn if you want to.
Armored Alysmith, not buffed in this case from the +2/+2 card we saw last game. But every time it hits, will heal him for 2 with the addition of the armor.
Rag comes out, and if he throws it out, there are 2 good spots, the Armorsmith and the Face, because it would get him down to 8 health. But even then, it's kind of like, eh.
I like the idea to play Kazakus, try to get the sheep, turn all minions into 1-1 sheep. That will give him, like, the ultimate authority on how the rest of the game plays out. Especially if he had Reno, it'd be very, very strong. He's going to go for the Rag. This could be a very weak Rag.
Oh, he gets the Alley Armorsmith. And for me, that was the best spot.
Absolutely.
You know, he gets no armor. He's just dead. Does nothing. There's no... Oh, wow. Is he actually going to use this? Take 8 damage and bash.
He'll bash, but the thing is he has Juicicar. And in fact, next turn of coin, he can use it for 6 health. And I think he may very well. Or it's not even, he doesn't even need the coin. He can play it straight next turn.
Throws out a minion.
He has Brawl still, too.
Volcanic Potion.
Too useful. I mean, it'll help him clear the 3-2. But it's not a sturdy minion going forward. No Kazakus either. He has such a large health pool that he's just playing this patient. You're going to see the double. Just a car turn. Refreshes his hero power, gets it again. He has 5 more armor with the shield block as well. And Caster finding his way into a good place here. Oh, that Forgotten Torch. You might as well forget about it right now. Not going to be too useful. He's going to save the Flamestrike again. Really, Kazakus this turn with the clear board. He's going to heal.
I wonder why he's saving that for so long.
You can make the argument that the longer you save Kazakus, the more sure you are of exactly which spell you get and why you're getting it. Because the situation could change at some point where the spell you've chosen is no longer the correct one. And you can get a 5 mana spell to end the game as well after playing him if you're in that position.
I wanted to see if it was actually yellow. Because, you know, sometimes Reno Mage decks can run like 1 copy, like what, 2 Frostbolts, something like that. But it is yellow, so it looks like he's just waiting for the right time, as you were saying. Now, he could shield block here, just get a draw, or he could just armor and pass. You know, this isn't, you know, it's not like you're racing to draw some specific combo and kill this guy. You know that he's got ice block up too.
This is going to be probably a fatigued warrior. And that's why he wants to wait and save his Kazakus. So if he gets a nice polymorph off, and then he can clear those sheep, and then suddenly the warrior just doesn't have minions, he wins the game. He has this portal, which can be used for clears later as well. I think he's going to ping pass. I think he's going to ping and pass. He could put a minion on the board, but it will likely be cleared, and he knows that. He just wants to... This is like a game of chicken.
Pretty much. And right now, the mage has 14 cards. The warrior has 13 cards. So this could be a very long game. We could be sitting back and waiting, especially if he takes this long to decide.
He wants to make it look like he has better options. We've seen this from Chunsu since the beginning of this tournament. And he will, I think, just ping pass.
Ping pass. You should have listened to Wolf about a minute ago, but yeah, it makes sense. As you said before, it's just a game of chicken. Who's going to play the cards? Like, you see immediately Caster knows what's up. He's going to do the same.
Mirror entity in the deck. A tech card against aggro. Very useless in this situation. Can be a shield for Brawl as well.
It's good against Grommash, too, in certain situations. It's pretty situational, though, as you're saying. And
I think he's just going to rope ping pass again.
It's like he's just trying to settle his nerves, so this is why he does this.
Let's actually take this time to think about The Korean Commerce thing is really funny, but I think this is like really strategic. Let's take a moment to think about how can he clear Gromosh. Oh, he's actually going to play the Flame Waker and protect it and do some additional damage to start poking down Caster here. The big question is, how is he dealing with Gromosh without using a Polymorph Potion? If he finds a way to do that, the Polymorph Potion can kill anything else he encounters. And we didn't see the big minions in this deck, you know? That's what I was talking about the previous set. He didn't have the Rag. He didn't have Ysera. If he kills Gromosh, I reckon we have a dead Caster in this game. And I think that Chunsu is
not one of us, right?
Yeah, no. maybe one of the Korean commentators. But like also, Caster, the player, if he cannot... If he kills Gromosh by any means, I don't... As far as I can tell, I don't think there's really any other big minions. He only has... He has 11 cards on deck. It looks a lot smaller than that on our Observer PC, but still...
It's 12 to 11 in favor of the mage.
If he kills that, I don't think there's that much left in the deck. He's already dealt with Sylvanas. He's dealt with the Armorsmith. He will have to deal with the Grimy Gadgets here, the +2/+2 to a minion in your hand at the end of your turn. He can use his portal for that. That'll be one less tool he has. Well, he's going to use this now. I think he's going to lose a little bit of patience here.
He may lose the game of chicken.
Yeah.
As you said, he's beginning to just throw stuff out, and it's just being nearly insta-cleared.
Bash and cool for this.
Yeah, and you can see Caster's not in any rush, and I don't mean his plays. I mean, just to do anything, really. He's just armoring and doing what's necessary to remove any threat that comes on the board.
You can draw, but I don't think he really wants to. He's going to go ahead and get his potion.
Okay, let's see. Add 3 demons to your hand, and what else? 3 friendly minions is scary with mirror image. Let's see. I'm gonna hover over this. Let's see. So summon 3 friendly minions that died, and add 3 random demons to your hand.
So he doesn't get the poly. He's just unlucky. I think that's one way you just straight kill the Gromosh. And he's chosen this path, which leads to, I mean, this is going to work out for him, because he's going to have minions. Like we said, this is a game of chicken, this is a war of attrition.
Yeah, it essentially adds 6 minions more to your hand, to your overall game. So
the thing is, the 3 minions that died this game, look at 2 of them, it could be right there at 0-1.
Yeah, exactly.
The 1-3, the 1-1, these minions.
The 0-1. I assume that the mirror image counts as a minion.
Yeah, it does.
And there's 2 of them.
So he's not even going to brawl. Absolutely not even a little bit scared or nervous about this. He's
with 41 health, I wouldn't be scared of 5 damage either.
He's going to play this before he loses these minions. Is this... I think this is... This choice is very interesting, Valdez. And gets 3 fairly mediocre minions.
Oh, the demons, they're all terrible.
Terrible demons.
Flame Imp, Wrathguard, Felguard. That's like...
That's game, almost certainly. We'll just simply brawl here. That was the card he was waiting for. That was the one card he was worried about. Was what Kazaka spell does he get?
And he has 2 brawls, too. So it's not like he's scared about a follow-up. So he can brawl once, and then if something crazy happens, he can brawl again. This turn, he can brawl an Ally Armorsmith and clear whatever with his Gore Howl.
He could still clear the... If he can clear Gromosh, he can still absolutely win this game by, you know... It's not, like, straight over from this, but I feel like being more patient here might have been the better choice. Here comes the brawl.
He makes sure that he draws a card. Yeah. See, I feel like Caster is playing this kind of matchup, this fatigue situation, a little bit better. He's, like, considering every little thing. Like, if I were playing this game, I would be like, okay, here we go, brawl. But, you know, he's thinking about it all. And we said it before, maybe Chunsu is going a little bit too fast.
Roaring Torch is drawn and Tharzan. Tharzan's going to help make it a lot easier to deal with the Gromosh. He's probably going to hold on to it for a bit longer. Direct damage with Roaring Torch is not really even something to be considered here. And in fact, with killing this Ally Armorsmith, he's going to prevent any sort of armor from being added. So he gets that damage in a sense. And he's going to flood the board again, only to be met with potentially another brawl.
Potentially. Maybe he'll make him draw again with the loot order.
interesting. He just plays all of them, you know? He plays all of the minions, giving Brawl the most value.
Grimy Gadgeteer is going to add to the Karamash attack.
That's the thing he's, you know, I was talking about earlier that could become a concern. Now that's the only minion in hand, it's quite powerful.
Okay. Here comes Grommash. And that's going to leave it at 6 health, so Fireball easily cleans that up.
Yeah. Okay, I mean, what minions are left for Caster? Is he just hoping he's going to win off of the armor he has alone? This is an interesting choice as well, because now he doesn't have this as a finishing tactic. He can't just burn armor here. He wants to bait out a better Brawl, I suppose.
Yeah, I think so. Say like, hey, I'm doing this because I have no other option. But we can see in the hand of Chunsu, there's only two minions.
Fireball is the easy way to clear this, and I just think it's the best option. Direct damage, again, not an issue. If he fatigues and he has no minions, that's how he wins. It's not going to be a game where we're sitting going like, oh my god, who's going to have... It's like, oh, he's got 4 fatigue damage in the game, and it's like that. It's not going to happen. So
it's about who has the minions at the end of it, as you said, and
revenge. Clear this. Use this for Howl. No more cost reduction. Forbidden Flame. Help him clear, possibly Grimy. And if there's any other minions left. I don't know if there is, to be honest.
There's 5 more cards in the caster's deck. 4 more left for Tunsu.
I don't think he should Arcane then.
Yeah.
If you can just wait until all the cards of the warrior are gone, make sure there's only one minion of his own on the board all the time so Brawl can't kill it. And then force all the weapons to be used that he encounters slowly, one minion at a time. He only has one minion left, though, in his hand. In deck, trying to think of other minions he could have. He could have, like, a Taz Dingo or something if he texts that in. I have seen that a lot on the ladder. What did he just draw? That legendary Harrison Jones!
Huh.
That is...
That's nice. You don't want to be drawing too much, but you get rid of the Gore Howl at least.
Yeah, draws one. And also picks up Bran. Which would have drawn him 2 cards, I guess, if he had it at the time.
He's going to Flood. And this is the Brawl turn.
Okay, he has another Bloodhoof. So he has the potential here to get this. He can also enrage it later on.
There are 2 cards. There are 2 cards in the deck of Chunsu right now, and if you are a pro player like Caster, you know what a Reno Mage deck looks like. You know there's probably Volcanic Potion. You know there's a Flame Strike, Forbidden Flame, Arcane Blast, Arcane Intellect. If you can guess that some of those cards are in the hand, then maybe you go full Brawl.
Oh! He does 22 damage because of the effect. What a sick play! The armor will do 22 damage to face, something Chunsu did not consider. And he concedes! What a play! What a sick play! I had not even considered that.
Yeah.
I highly doubt Chunsu did either.
I was thinking about it, but I just had... Like, I had not concerned, or considered even, that you could do that much damage to that minion. But... Shield Slam is the way.
Yeah, I was just thinking, like, okay, that's 4 damage you might take, that's insignificant, etc.,
yeah.
etc. Not the fact that overkill applies. And that was a great move there, and perhaps a mistake, you could argue, on Chunsu's part. So Caster will tie this up, removing his warrior deck, which was such a specific deck, so nice to get that one off the table.
It's really good that he was able to win with that deck here. Now he's got his Priest, which can pretty much win against anything, and his Mage, which I think that is the Freeze Mage, if I'm not mistaken. And what do we have left from Tunsu? We have the Mage and the Warrior still left over. So Mage and Warrior versus Mage and Priest. Who are you favoring coming into this one? I mean, just based on the decks? I feel like Caster is playing ever so slightly better.
Yeah, I would say so. The Mage deck feels, for Chunsu, feels like it's really figured out now, too. if you've written down every card, which they have papers over there, if you write down every card, he knows every deck and every card in the deck basically right now.
Very true. Guys, we're going to take a 5-minute break. We'll be right back.